Hi everyone, welcome back to my YouTube videos on the topic of martingales. In the previous videos, I told you about the optional stopping theorem, and starting from this video and in the next few videos, I'm going to give you examples of applications of this optional stopping theorem. And so the first popular example is this one. It's called the gambler's ruin problem. And so in this case, we again deal with what we define in the first video, which is called the betting random walk. In this case, we assume that the bets at each time step, the bets are always equal to one. We again have a probability of winning equal to P, a probability of losing equal to Q. At each game, P plus Q is equal to one. And so in this context, we kind of assume that a gambler goes to a casino, keeps betting $1 on the same game with, again, probability of winning, losing are P and Q. And this gambler is going to play until she has no more money or until she has reached some target that we call capital N. And the goal is to find the probability that the gambler is going to leave the casino with her target N, assuming that she goes to the casino with exactly X dollars. So it turns out that there are two popular proofs of this result. One is by using a technique which is well known, a very common technique in the field of discrete time Markov chain called first step analysis. And another way to prove the result is to use Martingale theory. So the first proof is a little bit messy, that brings some kind of complicated algebra, but just to show you the benefit of using Martingales so that you can compare both proofs, I'm going to first show the theorem using this first step analysis, and then you will see after that the proof using Martingale theory is in fact much more elegant. So if you don't care about this first proof, you can directly skip to the proof about Martingale theory. And when I'm doing the video editing, I'm going to tell you the time on the video so you can look at the bottom of your screen to see where you have to jump in the video to look at the proof using Martingale. So in this case, one way to solve the problem, one way to think of the process is really to think of the gambler's fortune as, let's say, an axis like that, where you have different possible values, so 0 and n. You have all the possible values in between. The gambler enters the casino with x dollars, and at each game, at each time step, the fortune can increase by 1 with probability P or decrease by 1 with probability Q. So we can summarize the problem with this little picture. So we have like a random walk starting at X, jumping to the right with probability P, to the left with probability Q, and the goal is to find the probability that this particle or random walk is going to reach N before 0. And so you see that, again, that's just the betting random walk in the particular case where all the bets are equal to 1. And in this case, the stopping time we are going to use to eventually apply the optional stopping theorem, but it's also something I'm going to define when I use this first step analysis, is going to be, so the first time at which the gambler reaches either 0 or n, one of the two boundaries, so that's going to be the infimum of n such that xn belongs to the set 0, n. So I'm going to use this notation xn for the betting random walk in this case. That's going to be the fortune of the gambler after playing n games. This evolves like an asymmetric random walk on the integer, but because we stop the process at time t, the process xnt is going to be stuck in this interval, and in the limit, when n goes to infinity, xnt goes to xt, and xt can only be equal to 0 or n. So the goal is to find In fact, this probability Px that we want to compute can be expressed as the probability starting from state x. So I'm going to write a little x here to say that we start from state x. So that's the probability starting from state x that xt is equal to n, is equal to capital N. So that's what we want to compute. So first possible proof, it's by using a first step analysis. So the idea is really to condition on the first outcome, the outcome of the first game, which can be winning or losing. So you see that given that the gambler is going to win the first game, she's going to be at a fortune equal to x plus 1 after the first game, or x minus 1 if she loses the first game. And so because of that, we can rewrite this px by saying that using just this conditioning, so that's going to be, let's say, the sum over all the possible values, let's say y, of the fortune at step 1. So it's going to be the probability starting from x that xt equals n, but given that she wins the first game or she loses the first game, so I'm going to write this by saying x1 equals y over all the possible values of y times the probability starting from x that x1 equals y. And you see that all those probabilities, these are conditional probabilities, probability of going from state x to state y, are all equal to zero except when y is equal to x plus 1 or x minus 1. So it's in fact a sum over y equals x plus or minus y of this. Now, if you write this more explicitly, you are going to get that. So those two numbers here are just for y equals x plus 1, x minus 1, is the probability of winning the first game or losing the first game. So those two probabilities are just equal to p or q. And these those conditional probabilities, you can get them by using some kind of restart argument by saying that given the gambler is going to, for instance, win the first game, then at time 1, her fortune is x plus 1, and her probability of reaching the target n before 0 becomes now px plus 1. Okay? So you can forget about the past, and so that just becomes, this quantity becomes just px plus 1 when y equals x plus 1, or px minus 1 when y is equal to x minus 1. And so eventually you obtain that this sum here is simply equal to p times px plus 1 plus q times px minus 1. So again, the interpretation is, looking at the picture, is if she starts with x dollars, then two things can happen. With probability p, she's going to have x plus $1 at the next time step, in which case the probability that she wins eventually becomes px plus 1. Or with probability q, she's going to have x minus $1, in which case her probability of winning eventually becomes px minus 1. So you obtain this equation, and now you see, so we have this kind of not very nice system where px is related to px plus 1 and px minus 1 in this way. So we have a set of, like, a bunch of equations, a system of equations. So that's a linear system, but involving, like, three consecutive terms in this sequence px. And we want to try to compute that. So the first trick is just to observe that this px, you can write it again as, to have the same coefficient appearing here, you can think of px as just p plus q times x, because p plus q is equal to 1. So I can write that this is the same as p plus q times px. And then this allows you to put the terms in front of p and the ones in front of q on the same side. And so eventually you get that p times px plus 1 minus px is equal to q times px minus px minus 1. So just looking at some basic algebra like this. And so eventually you obtain that the differences between two consecutive terms exhibit some kind of geometric progression. And so from that we easily deduce that px plus 1 minus px, so is the same as the previous term, but with a coefficient q over p in front. So that's going to be the ratio of our geometric progression. So we have this times px minus px minus 1. And now it's using this, we can extract the value of px as a function of p0 and pn, and then we can use boundary conditions to have an explicit expression of px eventually. So the way we do this is just by using something that we call a telescopic series. So the idea is to write px as a sum of differences, of sum of kind of increments. So you can write that px is equal to px minus 1 plus px minus 1 minus px minus 2, and you go all the way to plus p1 minus p0. So to see that it's true, well, indeed, those two terms cancel, the next two and so on, you eventually have on this side px minus p0, but you see that p0 clearly is equal to 0. If the gambler goes to the casino with no money, the probability that like time t becomes 0, okay, from the beginning she's not going to play, and so that means that the probability that she is going to win eventually is 0. So this term, because it's 0, indeed we have this equation, and now we know all those terms they are of this form. So now using just some basic induction, you can prove that this quantity is going to be q at the power q over p at the power maybe x, let's check, times p1 minus p0. So let's see if the power is correct here. So what you want is, let's say the sum here should be equal to x plus 1, yeah? So that works, okay? So you have this expression for this number here. And so this means that you can simplify this sum here and say that this is q over p at the power x plus q over p at the power x minus 1. And you go all the way to q over p at the power 0, I guess, for this term. And you have this times p1 minus p0, but we said p0 is 0 anyway. So this times p1. Okay. And then you can simplify this expression. You can simplify this expression. So now we have two different cases. So it's what happens when. So let me see here, there is probably a mistake because I go from 1 to x. So I need, in fact, this starts at x minus 1 here. Okay, I just had a typo here. So in this sum, so you have two different expressions depending on whether q and p are equal or not. If p and q are equal, you just get, so x terms times p1. So this is going to be, I'm going to write here, px can be equal to x times p1, and this is if p and q are equal, okay? But then if p and q are different, then you have a geometric progression, and that's going to give you, so 1 minus the ratio at the power of the number of terms, so that's x, so you get 1 minus q over p at the power x divided by 1 minus q over p, and again times p1, and this is if p is different from q. You see, p is different from q, indeed the q over p is different from 1, so this is well defined, but when p equals q, you have a particular case where the sum here is just equal to x. So we get this expression, so it's not done yet, because we have indeed the expression of px, but as a function of p1, and we don't know p1 yet, and so the way you eventually close the system and get some explicit expression, it's by using another boundary condition, which is the fact that Pn should be equal to 1. Indeed, if the gambler plays until she has n dollars, and if when she goes to the casino she already has n dollars, then again she's not going to play, and t is equal to 0, and xt, which is x0, is already equal to n. So in this case, we indeed have that Pn is equal to 1, and so that means that taking n, x equals n here, so we are going to do this now, take x equals n, in this, in those equations, we get that Pn equals n times p1, but we know that Pn is equal to 1, so that gives you p1 in this case equals 1 over n, okay? And in this case here, we are going to get that Pn again, so this time is going to be equal to 1 minus q over p at the power n divided by 1 minus q over p. We know that, so times p1, and we know that this should be equal to 1, and so now that gives you a new value for p1. In this case, p1 is going to be equal to p1 is going to be equal to 1 minus q over p divided by 1 minus q over p at the power n. Okay, so I'm kind of running out of space, but then eventually if you replace p1, p1 by the value we found here. So in the case of fair game, when p equals q, so that means that you are equally likely to win or lose, then we said that the p1 should be equal to 1 over n, so this becomes x over n. While in this case, so this is in the case of a fair game, if the game is not fair and p and q are different, we are going to, eventually we have to replace p1 by this value here. And so you see that we have a simplification with the numerator here and the denominator there, but then we have this denominator that appears, so that's this at the power n, and this p1 disappears. So that's eventually our solution. The probability that starting from with x dollars, going to the casino with x dollars, the gambler is indeed going to reach her target before being ruined, with probability x over n if she plays a fair game, but with this over probability if she plays a game that is not fair. So now it turns out that you can kind of check that at least when n is large and x is well between 0 and n, let's say, and even if p is slightly less than q, meaning that you have a game that is slightly unfavorable, you can easily prove that this quantity is going to go to zero pretty quickly with n. Even if you take x pretty large, if you are kind of away from n, it's not likely that eventually the gambler is going to quit a winner. So that was the proof using this first step analysis. You can see indeed in the slide that this is the result we wanted to get. And so that concludes the proof using using this technique. And now let's look at the proof using Martingale theory instead. So we again want to prove, to compute this quantity, the probability of winning, which is, so Px is the probability that Xt is equal to n. So to compute both probabilities without using some messy algebra like in the previous proof, and so much more elegant techniques using Martingale theory and the optional solving theorem, what we are going to do is, well, first, we are going to distinguish between those two cases, whether you have a fair game or not, because you see that we have two different expressions, depending on whether the game is fair or not. So first, let's look at what happens when we have a fair game. So in this case, this means that P equals Q. And in this case, we saw that our betting random walk is a martingale. So in this case, we know that Xn is a martingale. And we can use, in this case, the martingale, the optional stopping theorem for martingale. So why is it the case? Well, Xn is a martingale, T is clearly almost surely finite. It's going to take a finite number of steps. I mean, after an almost surely finite time, the gambler is going to be at zero or n. So T is almost surely finite. This process is bounded. Okay, it's clear that Xn is between zero and n. So we can indeed use, and T is a stopping time. So we can indeed use the first version of the optional stopping theorem for martingale. And so what this is going to tell us is that the expected value of xt equals expected value of x0. But because we know that the gambler is going to start with x dollars, then this expected value of x0 is just equal to x. Now, there is another way to write this expected value of xt. It's just by looking at the definition of expected value. We know that xt, t is defined here again. By definition, xt is going to be equal to 0 or n. So this expected value should be equal to 0 times the probability that xt equals 0. So of course, this whole expression is equal to 0. And then plus n times the probability that xt is equal to n. But this probability that xt is equal to n, that's exactly our probability of winning. So this whole thing is equal to n times px. And that's it. That concludes the proof. So that's, you see, that's pretty short. At least in the case of fair game, you have n px is equal to x. And so that tells you that px is indeed equal to x over n, like we proved using a first step analysis, except that now the proof is very elegant and very short. So now let's look at second case where we have to deal with an unfair game. So case number two, now we are going to assume that P is different from Q, so the game is unfair, it might be favorable or unfavorable. And so in this case, it turns out that we can prove that Q over P at the power Xn is a martingale. So that's going to be the first step of the proof. We want to show that. And if we can prove that, then we can again use the optional stopping theorem to compute this probability px. So here indeed, to check this, you look at the expected value of xn plus 1 given fn, the past. So given all the outcomes of the games number 1, 2, 3 up to n, we want to find the expected value of the fortune of the gambler at time n plus 1. We want to look at. It's in fact, we want to look at this process. So we look instead at Q over P at the power xn plus 1. given Fn. And so if you look at this quantity, you see that xn plus 1 again can be equal to xn minus 1 or xn plus 1 with probabilities p and q. So in fact, this this conditional expectation is going to be so q over p. I'm going to write instead first with probability p, the gambler is going to win. And so with this probability p, this quantity is going to be equal to q over p at the power xn plus 1. Okay? Or it's going to be with probability q equal to q over p at the power xn minus 1. And so looking at this quantity, you can simplify things a little bit. You see I'm using xn here because we condition on fn. So that's exactly like given x0, x1 up to xn. So we end up with indeed something that is xn measurable. We can express this using xn. And so we can simplify this expression and get that this is equal to q over p. At the power xn, and what's left is on this side you have p times q over p, and here you are going to have a q times p over q. This is the what's left after you extract this term is a q divided by q over p, so that's q times p over q. And then you see that there is this simplification, the p is here simplified, the q's. Then you have q plus p, but q plus p equals 1, so this whole expression is equal to 1. So indeed, the conditional expectation of q over p at the power xn plus 1, given the past, is equal to q over p at the power xn. This shows that indeed this new process q over p at the power xn is a martingale. So now that we know this, we can use the optional stopping theorem to conclude the proof and give some explicit expression of px. In this case, we are going to get that. So this px, I'm looking at, so again, we can use the optional stopping theorem. Maybe I should justify that quickly. Again, the time t is, as before, almost surely finite. This process, again, because xn is between 0 and n, this process is going to be bounded. And so we indeed have the two assumptions of the first version of the optional stopping theorem. So by this optional stopping theorem, we can say that the expected value of not xt, again, I'm making the same mistake, it's now this is our martingale, so we can say that the expected value of q over p at the power xt is going to be equal to expected value of q over p at the power x0. Okay, now as before, we assume that the gambler starts with x dollars, which means that x0 is going to be equal to x. So this is equal to q over p at the power x. But then you can, as before, re-express this quantity, looking at whether xt is equal to 0 or n. And so in this case, you get exactly that with probability, so px, the gambler is going to win with probability px, in which case this xt is equal to n, and so you get px times q over p at the power n. But then she's going to lose with probability 1 minus px, and in which case xt is equal to 0, so this q over p at the power xt is equal to 1. So you just get this expression, then you can simplify things a little bit. And you see that Eventually, from that, you easily deduce that Px is equal to. So, here, maybe I can simplify a little bit. Here on this side, you get this one again, minus Px times 1 minus Q over P at the power n. And now it becomes clear that this Px here is going to be 1 minus this quantity divided by 1 minus this one. So you get 1 minus Q over P at the power x divided by this quantity here. And so this is 1 minus Q over P at the power capital N. So checking the slide again, you see that we end up with, as previously, the same solution, except that now it seems that the algebra is less messy. In fact, you can also look at other examples of application where the first step analysis would not work because there are too many possible things happening at the first step. While if you use this technique using the optional stopping theorem for Martingale, the technique is not going to get more difficult. The calculations are not going to get more difficult, even if the process is in fact more difficult, while for a first step analysis, it can become messy very quickly.